Welcome to Hard Talk. I'm Stephen Sacker. When Iran's President Rouhani was convincingly re-elected last year, Iranians seemed hopeful their living standards might improve. Well, they haven't. Inflation, poverty, water shortages, corruption, on a host of measures, things appear to be getting worse. And now Iran is again facing US sanctions after Donald Trump walked away from that nuclear deal with Tehran. My guest is Iranian political analyst, Professor Mohamed Marandi. Is Iran on the brink of an economic and political crisis? Mohamed Marandi in Tehran. Welcome to Hard Talk.
Thank you.
There is a time delay on this line, but nonetheless, my first question is a simple one. There was a lot of hope around the re-election of President Rouhani last year. It seems to have evaporated. Why?
Well, obviously, there are a host of difficulties that exist in Iran, mostly economic. The dissatisfaction that exists in the country, according to polls, is focused on jobs and inflation. But we have to take into account the fact that the United States has not abided by its side of the bargain in the nuclear deal. When the Iranians signed on to the nuclear deal and gave significant concessions, they did this in order to ease tensions and to prevent the United States from continuing to have an excuse against Iran. And the Americans were supposed to abide by their side of the bargain, and they didn't. Under Obama, they didn't. The United States, in violation of the nuclear deal, they imposed new sanctions. The Treasury imposed sanctions on companies and individuals. And new laws were passed by Congress, the visa restriction laws, as well as the renewal of the Iran Sanctions Act. All of these were in violation of the nuclear deal. In fact, the Iranians, despite the fact that they signed on to the agreement, were unable to send money out of the country through the banks. Nor bring in money.
You've chosen in that answer to direct much of your response toward Donald Trump and his policies toward Iran, but I cannot but help notice that looking at the wave of protest, the unrest that we see filmed on social media and put online by Iranians in various towns and cities, and we've seen it at the end of July, we've seen it through the course of the last 8 or 9 months in various towns and cities. The chants go like this. We've got death to Khamenei, the supreme leader. We've got death to Rouhani, death to the dictatorship. They say things like, leave Syria, think about us instead. Death to the Islamic Republic and shame on the mullahs. These are the things that many Iranians are saying on the streets right now.
Well, Stephen, I think you have to keep in mind that in Iran, we have regular elections, and elections in Iran have very high turnouts. In fact, President Rouhani was elected with a turnout of something like 73 or 74%. So the legitimacy of the political institutions in the eyes of the people is very high in the country. The fact that protests happen in Iran is not extraordinary, but I would like you to keep this in mind, that unlike in Western countries, where, for example, in the riots in London in 2011, where social media was being used by the rioters or the protesters or whatever you'd like to call them, the British government had the cooperation of BlackBerry, of Facebook, of Twitter. The people who instigated the riots, two young men, they were sentenced each to 4 years in prison in the UK, and five, six people were killed, over 3,000 people, 3,000 to 4,000 people were arrested, and they were universally condemned. In the case of Iran, you have a host of Persian language foreign media outside the country, based in the West, some of them government owned, like the British and American governments, some of them funded by governments that are almost universally inciting violence, carrying out information warfare, trying to create a sense of depression and hopelessness among Iranians 24 hours a day.
Professor Marandi, surely the anger that we see on the streets in those protests and the sense of disillusion, they're not some sort of Western organized conspiracy. They're the product of quite simple things, like the fact that inflation right now is rampant. Some calculated it running at over 200% if one takes into account the plunge in the value of the Iranian currency. Look at unemployment rates. Look at the shortage of water. Look at a whole host of different issues which are affecting the everyday lives of Iranians. It's no Western conspiracy to say that Iranians are thoroughly hacked off with life under this regime.
Well, I would say that it's the same sort of terminology, regime, that you use is a sign of how, in the West, Iran is looked upon and has historically been looked upon. For almost 40 years now, Iran has been a regime that is, and from the false narratives that we see in the West, a regime that is illegitimate, that is violent, that is unpopular, that is corrupt, and that is about to implode. I've been hearing this since I was a teenager. And so far, we haven't seen that happen. In fact, the paradox, the unresolvable paradox here, is that on the one hand, Iran is a regime that's about to explode or implode. And on the other hand, it's a growing menace to world peace and stability. So it's a growing threat, according to the narrative, but it's also corrupt and collapsing. You can't have your cake and eat it too. The fact on the ground is that in Iran, you have people who protest, and there are legitimate protests, and there are grievances. But on the other hand, there are external forces who have been trying very hard to turn legitimate protests into riots. It's very well documented. It's not some conspiracy. It's a reality.
Well, we'll get back to Iran's external policies later, because you make a very interesting point about the way the West perceives them. But let's stick with internal issues for a while longer. And no question, the US reimposition of sanctions, I'm sure you would agree with me, is a factor in the deterioration of late in the Iranian economy, not least because it's affected the value of the riyal in a very negative way. The currency has plunged, I think, 50% in the last few months. Here's something that your foreign minister, Zarif, tweeted after the announcement of the reimposition of U.S. sanctions. He said, the world won't follow Donald Trump's impulsive tweeted diktats. He said, just ask the EU, Russia, China, and dozens of our other trading partners. It seems Iran was very confident that all of those other signatories to the multilateral deal would continue their commitment to an open economic relationship with Iran, despite the reimposition of U.S. sanctions. But it's not working that way, is it?
Well, I wouldn't agree with that assessment. I would say that the world is changing. I would say that the United States has shown itself to be unreliable by tearing up an international commitment. It has shown itself to have no respect for European countries. Basically, Trump, by tearing up the agreement, has told the British, the French, and the Germans that you abide by my dictates and you follow my orders. And the Europeans either have to abide by U.S. demands or they have to grow a spine.
My point is simply that a host of European companies, for example, I could quote you Daimler, I could quote you Total or Maersk, the shipping company, or Peugeot, all of these companies have either abandoned plans or really rode back on plans to invest or put new monies into their Iranian ventures because of the power of the U.S. economy and the signal sent from Washington that any businesses now doing deals with Iran will come under very close scrutiny and suffer consequences from the United States. The power of the U.S. economy is something that you guys seem to have underestimated.
I don't think anyone in Iran underestimates it. But the fact that Trump is behaving like a mafia boss is nothing to be proud of. And it's nothing to be proud of when a country is ordered by the United States not to cooperate with another country. That's what I was trying to say.
Iran is in a hole, and we can see it from the plunge in your currency to the abandonment of joint venture deals and European investment. We can see it in the oil business. We're about to see it more in the shipping business as well, because let's not forget phase one of the reimposition of sanctions came on August 7, but more expansive sanctions are going to come in November. I come back to the point, you can talk about the morality of it, you can talk about the rights and wrongs of it, but in the end, the Iranian economy is in a very deep hole.
Well, the Iranian economy is definitely going to face difficulty. It is facing difficulty, and it will continue to face difficulty in the months ahead. But I assure you that Iran will persevere. We've gone through greater difficulties. In the 1980s, when the United States was helping Saddam Hussein, giving him, and the Europeans, by the way, giving him chemical weapons to use against Iranians, we survived. We were alone for 8 years. One of the few countries that actually supported us was Syria. We survived the chemical attacks. I survived two chemical attacks. Our country survived the war. We've gone through much worse. The current administration is going to go through difficulty. They've made significant mistakes over the past few months. They have to rectify those mistakes. But without a doubt, after a few months, the economy will stabilize. And as I said, it won't be easy. No one's claiming that it's going to be easy. But this is something that has been unjustly imposed upon the Iranian people. The Americans want to crush the Iranian people. They want to humiliate the Iranian people, and that's simply not going to work.
You call it crushing. The Americans would say a fundamental realignment of Iran's foreign policies in particular. It is interesting, is it not, that Mike Pompeo, when he talked about the strongest sanctions in history being imposed, also pointed to the 12 US conditions which would see those sanctions lifted. And in essence, if one sort of gets to the heart of it, they demand that Iran completely end the significant bulk of its nuclear program. They end further ballistic missile development, end support for groups like Hezbollah and the Houthis in Yemen, and conduct a complete withdrawal from Syria. Now, I suspect you're going to tell me absolutely none of that is going to happen. But in that case, Iran is going to face indefinite and extremely punishing economic consequences.
Well, first of all, there are a host of countries that will continue to cooperate with Iran, especially Asian countries. And I think across the world, people are recognizing that the United States is behaving in a dangerous manner, using the dollar, using financial institutions as weapons. And this is something that we now see that they're using against Turkey. And that is going to increasingly isolate the United States. Of course, the United States is still a very important power. But what I'm saying is that the world is changing as well. But Iran will not be able to change its foreign policy, because Iran's policy in Syria and Iraq is what prevented ISIS from coming into Iran. Not only did Iran stop the extremists that Western governments helped create with the Saudis. Look at the Defense Intelligence Agency document of 2012. The most important military intelligence organization in the world, in the Pentagon, stated that from early on in Syria, the dominant militant forces were the extremists, and that they were going to create a Salafist entity between Syria and Iraq, and that the regional regimes that were allied to the United States were supporting this. And then General Flynn, later on in an interview, admitted, he was the head of that organization, he admitted that the United States had took a willful decision to help its regional allies do this. What was the group that later made a regime between Syria and Iraq? It was ISIS. The United States helped the extremists. Well, How could Iran stand back and allow Damascus and Baghdad to have the black flags raised over them?
You may make that point. I'm more interested in what this means for Iran. And there's no question. I mean, it's quite obvious that Iran's strategic commitment to its support of the Assad government and its own military presence in Syria is long-term, but it is also extremely expensive. One of the most respected experts on Mideast politics and diplomacy, Nadeem Shahadi, he reckons that it could have already cost Iran up to 100 $100 billion US dollars, all of its military and political commitment to the Assad government since the war started. Add to that the $1 billion or so every year that Tehran spends on Hezbollah in Lebanon. Add to that the cost now of Iran's involvement in Yemen as well. It comes back to what is sustainable and what is not sustainable. In the context of the economy that we've discussed today, are you telling me that Iran's foreign policy is sustainable in economic terms?
Stephen, let's not talk about Yemen. Yemen is, there's a starvation siege imposed on the people of Yemen by the Saudi government with the help of Western countries. Western countries are helping the Saudis starve the Yemenis. They're helping the massacre and slaughter of the Yemenis. And Western governments are implicated in crimes against humanity. Their leaders have blood on their hands. The Canadian prime minister, who's had a fallout with the Saudi government, was a very good enabler of Saudi war crimes.
Again, so Yemen aside, if I may say so, Syria, Professor Marandi, and, these I'm numbers, not, I'm not trying me. To discuss the rights and wrongs of the Yemen war. And believe me, we put on the spot Saudi officials, US officials, UK officials, for their responsibilities when it comes to Yemen. But my point was a very direct one. You tell me that the Iranian government will not in any way change its foreign and external policies. I put it to you that Iran increasingly is going to find those policies unsustainable economically.
No, I was trying to respond. First of all, the country is surrounded Yemen. Iran cannot even help the people of Yemen. If they could, they should. But on the other hand, when it comes to Syria and Iraq, the International Institute for Strategic Studies is by no means connected to Iran. They say that Iran's military expenditure is 19th in the world. Iran spends less on its military than Saudi Arabia, than the Israeli regime, than Turkey, than Iraq, than the United Arab Emirates, with a population and a passport holding up population of 1 million. So either your numbers are incorrect, or the International Institute for Strategic Studies, whose job it is to monitor military spending, is nonsense. I've been to Syria 9 or 10 times over the past 7 years, and I've never seen such huge amounts of money being spent in Syria. It's the United States that has spent trillions of dollars in wars in Iraq, destroying Libya, helping the Saudis destroy Yemen, and to create a dirty war in Syria. They're the ones who've created this mess.
Let's bring it back to what is happening inside Iran. You haven't tried to dispute with me that economic times are tough. There is anger on the streets. We've all seen it. It is interesting to me that certain politicians, I'm going to name one, that is former President Ahmadinejad, are now making very public calls for President Rouhani to go, and to go now. And even Supreme Leader Ali Khamenei has talked about gross mismanagement, which he says is now afflicting Iran. It does seem, and I know that you don't like all this talk of hardliners against moderates and reformers, but it does seem in the current context as though the hardliners are making a concerted effort to regain complete political power in Tehran.
Well, Stephen, I'm glad you acknowledge that in Iran we have different political parties with differing political perspectives that argue with each other, that carry out public debates, because that's not the sort of narrative we hear in the West. What we usually hear about Iran is very similar to what we hear about Saudi Arabia or the United Arab Emirates, where there are no politics. There's just a dictator who makes the decisions. Yes, President Rouhani, his position is not as strong as it was before, obviously. But that he has the legitimacy. He's the president of the country. He was elected. The leader supported him in his recent speech. And of course, there's mismanagement in this country. There's mismanagement in your country. Right now, you're going through Brexit, and everyone's saying that Theresa May has made a mess of things. Within her own party, they're attacking her left, right, and center. That's politics. So in Iran, when we have politics, it's called some sort of internal warfare. In the West, it's called democracy and checks and balances.
Maybe one reason, I don't know if it's called internal warfare, but one reason it is seen in a very particular light in Iran is that what we do know, and independent human rights groups like Amnesty International report this repeatedly, is that those who express dissent, particularly at times of rising tension, as I think we see in Tehran today, those who express dissent, whether it be straightforward political or whether it be cultural, as women fight for greater rights and freedom from oppressive laws, or whether it be religious, with religious minorities demanding an end to discrimination, what we see at times of tension is that more of those dissidents are locked up. And according to Amnesty's latest report, and I'm going to quote from it directly, heavy suppression of rights to freedom of expression, association and assembly, as well as freedom of religion and belief. The government has imprisoned scores of individuals who voiced dissent. Trials are systematically unfair. Torture and other ill treatment widespread. That is what happens in Tehran when tensions rise.
Well, first of all, Amnesty International is not totally independent. The head of Amnesty International USA until recently was a person who was very closely associated with Hillary Clinton and who worked in the State Department under Hillary Clinton. So it is based in the West, and it's based on Western so-called values. I wonder what those are at times. But when it comes to, if you're talking about political prisoners, it'd be good to include people like Julian Assange, who is right now, in my opinion, a political prisoner being held in the heart of London because he's exposed the crimes of the United States and Iraq, because he's exposed how Hillary Clinton used the Democratic National Committee to cheat her rival, Sanders, from being the candidate for the Democratic Party. And now he's being punished for it. He's been accused of raping two women, falsely accused as far as we know. And then you have other examples. You have people like Helen Thomas,
Professor
who was
Marandi,
the White House correspondent for nine administrations.
Professor Marandi, you have the right to question what happens in other countries, but in a format such as ours, it's more useful, I think, if you respond to my direct questions about what's happening in your own country. When you see the level of repression in Tehran today, do you yourself, as an academic, as a man who knows the freedoms that come with academia and the need for freedom of expression, do you not worry about the curtailment of freedom of expression in Iran today?
Come on, Stephen. You just a few minutes ago were saying how the different political factions and the hardliners and the reformists and the moderates, and they're all out at each other's throats. And then what is all that about? Because there is freedom of speech in this country. There are arguments and debate. Is it an ideal? Is it a utopia? Of course it isn't. But we are also a country that we have the United States surrounding us. You have U.S. troops in the Persian Gulf. You have U.S. troops in Iraq and Afghanistan. You have the United States constantly threatening the country. You have Western countries funding groups that carrying out psychological warfare. You have thousands of MEK, former terrorists, you know them very well yourself, I'm sure, who fought for Saddam Hussein. Many of them are in Albania. They're paid trolls, and they are constantly carrying out, through multiple online personas and different accounts, psychological warfare against Iran. And then when the United States indicts 13 Russians for, what was it, creating political discord in the United States before the presidential elections because of a few Facebook ads, this is double standards. The reality on the ground is that Iran, despite the antagonism and despite the hostility that's coming from Western powers, is much more free than any of the U.S. allies in this part of the world.
All right. Mohamed Marandi, I thank you very much for joining me from Tehran.